Father. heart in your dwelling place of joy. O Lord, unto you be glory forever.
Thank you.
incense and ask for your mercy, O Lord. Peace be with you.
And with your spirit.
The Gospel of our Lord Jesus Christ according to St. John. Proclaim life to the world. Let us listen to the proclamation of life and salvation for our souls.
Remain silent, O listeners. The Holy Gospel is about to be proclaimed to you. Listening in glory and thanks to the word of the living God.
The Lord Jesus says, whoever has my commandments and observes them is the one who loves me. And whoever loves me will be loved by my Father. And I will love him, and I will reveal myself to him. Judas, not the Iscariot, said to him, Rabbi, then what happened that you will reveal yourself to us and not to the world? Jesus answered and he said to him, whoever loves me will keep my word, and my Father will love him, and we will come to him and make our dwelling with him. Whoever does not love me does not keep my words. Yet the word which you hear is not mine, but that of the Father who sends me. I have told you this while I am with you. The Advocate, the Holy Spirit that the Father will send in my name, he will teach you everything and remind you of all that I have told you. Peace I give with you. My peace I give unto you. Not as the world gives, do I give to you. Do not let your hearts be troubled or afraid. This is the truth. Peace be with you. And so our Lord Spirit strengthens the very heart of what being Christian actually means. Simply being baptized does not make us Christian. The fathers of the church refer to baptism as being the doorway. It opens to us and establishes a life that we are meant to follow on the path. So the mere fact of being baptized in itself is the beginning of a life and not simply a ceremony. In the modern world, many of us will have baptisms take place or try to have them take place in which the family itself has no desire whatsoever to live a Catholic life. We reduce then the sacred mysteries down to magic tricks, an amulet, something we do to babies. But it is the beginning and the opening of a life, which our Lord touches upon here, which is to hear the word of God and to embrace it. To be baptized and not to convert and to embrace the word of the Lord is, in short, either a reducing to simply a magical ceremony so we can have a party after, or is blasphemous and sacrilegious. So what our Lord is touching here is he's saying he speaks publicly. The word is given. The gospel exists. The word is heard. Those who love me, as we mentioned over these last couple of weeks, in love is reciprocal. It's between two people, or between more than one people, but at least it's something that is reciprocated. When it's not reciprocated, it's not love. So the first thing our Lord says, I reveal my word. Those who love me hear my word and keep it. They observe it. Therefore, my Father then will love them, and I will reveal myself to him. And so as I answer to St. Jude, he's saying that my Father will love the one who keeps my word. And we will come to him, and we will reveal ourselves to him, and we will make our dwelling with him. So now he takes it one more step. Not only will be this reciprocal relation between someone who embraces the word of the gospel and whose life will then be conformed to this word, but that my Father and I will come and we will dwell, we will manifest and make ourselves present within this individual. It is an experiential grace which is given. And that is a whole other sermon. Not series of sermons, on what this experiential grace is, where God himself within the individual is to confirm and transform that person into a child of God. And that is the answer to St. Jude of how I reveal myself to specific people and not to all the human race. As a side point on these Sundays after Pentecost, we keep in mind that after our Lord's resurrection, he only appeared to believers. He didn't simply appear in the courtyard of the temple and say, ta-da! It wasn't a magic trick. It's a life of transformation to the life of glory. So that when our Lord enters into that glorious existence, which is the life of God, the divinization we call it, he appears to those who believe, who have heard his word. Now, maybe a lot of people. St. Paul speaks about one event where our Lord appears to 500 people all at once. We have no idea what it was, when it was, how it took place. He just mentioned it in passing in one of the letters. As he says to those who are reading and listening to this letter, he says, yes, and he appeared to 500. And then goes on and names other individual people to whom our Lord appeared. That is an external manifestation of what our Lord is talking about in the gospel today. And so what this experiential grace does of the Father, the Son, and the Holy Spirit dwelling within us is a transformation to further bring about this greater love of reciprocation. So that the individual in whom this grace is found desires to go more profoundly into the gospel. To be more profoundly transformed by grace. For the children of God, the phrase good enough doesn't exist. For someone simply to say, well, I'm good enough. Well, yes, if I compare myself to somebody else, I suppose. But for the
the children of God, their standard is the gospel, and ultimately is God himself.
Our Lord says in the Sermon on the Mount, you must be perfect as your heavenly Father is perfect. There is always another step to take more profoundly in the life of virtue. Who can say that they're honest enough because I only lie sometimes and say that that is a good comparison to God? Who can say that I love enough, that charity inspires my life, though I really don't like that great antimony? But everybody else is fine. And in comparison to say that is sufficient in comparison with the God who is infinite charity. Grace always pushes us forward. It is discomforting. But it is how our Lord desires that we do not waste the time on earth. We are only given a short amount of time. Relative to eternity, it is nothing. Which is why for all of the damned, there is nothing but contempt and scorn. Because compared to the moment, the eternal moment, compared to 40 or 50 or 60 or 70 years, it's nothing. And you wasted it totally. The most profound reaction to the damned is one of contempt and scorn. Because you're stupid. So what our Lord says is this reciprocation that goes back and forth pushes us further into this life of virtue. Now as an application, I just want to finish with, because I mentioned to you last month, that what I'd like to do during these months in the centennial celebration of Fatima is mid-month to speak about what is taking place at that. We could do a whole series of sermons on what's taking place in the world at the time, because it makes much more sense what's being said at Fatima, but we don't have time here Sunday. So specifically what takes place in June of 1917, June 13th, remember this is the first month that is an act of faith, it's the reciprocation of these children. They have seen something wonderful in the love of men, this magnificent woman of light. And they're told to come the next month on the 13th also. So this reciprocal action is already in place here. And as I mentioned to you in the month of May, we see in 1916 the preparation of these children. And so each of us can always draw something from what Providence is doing with these little children. And they are little. Lucia is the oldest of the three, and she's only 10. So they return to the cove, to the place where they had been the month before, in this case, June 13th. And at this point, human beings being what they are, even without the internet and telephone, chatter has gone around the villages. These little children have seen something. And if not as an act of faith, at least curiosity, there's about 50 people who show up this month. With the children. And they begin to pray the rosary. The rosary will be the foundation of Fatima continually. And as the place before, we have the luminous orb that shows and out appears Our Lady in this light. And she appears once again over the evergreen trees, about 3 feet tall, which is why the statue of Our Lady of Fatima always has a bush on it. Now, some of the individuals who were there, we might see whether they saw or not the actual movement. Children see. All three of them see. But Francisco, the little boy, doesn't hear. Like last month in May, he doesn't hear what is being said. He can see everything that his sister and his cousins see. And she tells them once again, that you're going to come next month also, on the 13th. That you must recite the rosary every day. And then she tells Lucia, you must learn to read. Now, this is one of these little details which seems to be what does heaven care about this little girl reading? But we see it as a detail of how God's grace works with individuals. God speaks to each
each of us individually in a way that he does not speak to others, because each person is unique. And never from the time of creation to the day of judgment will it be the same. Each person is unique. So why did she tell her to read? She then tells Jacinta and Francisco that you will be shortly with me in heaven. Now we know that these two children, and we know the rest of the story, these two children do die in that pandemic of influenza, of the flu, which took place after World War I. So it's a question of just a couple of years before these children die. So she tells them, the two of you will be with me soon in heaven. And Lucia complains. She's told to read, but she's been Lucia then is told by Our Lady, you will remain behind. And Lucia complains because she doesn't want to be left alone. She doesn't want to lose her presence. These are the three of them that shepherd together. They're very close. They're always together. They pray together. They shepherd their animals together. And Our Lady says to Lucia, does this upset me? And then she tells her, do not be discouraged. I will never forsake you. So this aspect of reading for Lucia is to prepare her for, again, historically we know, Lucia is going to live for almost a century afterwards. She's going to live, her life is in her 90s when she finally dies. I will never forsake you, and my immaculate heart will always be your refuge and your pathway that conducts you to God. It's one of the famous quotations from Fatima. That my immaculate heart, my stainless heart, immaculate just means without stain, untarnished, that my pure heart, my unstained heart, will be a place of refuge for you, and it will also be the path that will conduct you to God. At this point, she then tells the three children a secret. That's all we're told. We don't know. It was never revealed. It's not the third secret. It has never been told to us what was said to these children. But we can have a hunch that what takes place is the preparation of the children for the next month. Because these children are going to be abused by the adults around them. Physically. The Freemasonic governor will have them thrown in jail for days, a couple days. No warrants of arrest, no trial, no appeal, just throws them in jail. It's hard to imagine. 1917. Then she gives the children, after the secret, whatever it was, she gives the children a vision of her immaculate heart, her maternal, stainless heart. But the heart is surrounded, not the normal way that we see with the crown of the flowers around it, but the heart is surrounded by thorns, and the thorns pierce this maternal heart. And they are, of course, the children were given to understand, a symbol of the sins of the human race that pierce the heart of God, the heart of the Blessed Virgin Mary, that they are offensive. In the modern world, we too quickly, besides not only saying God is good enough, we also say God understands. And we just brush away all the offensive things that we do in our lives. We no longer call them sin. Pius XII in the 1940s, he said that the sin of the modern world is to have no sense of sin. The very fundamental idea to call evil good. They will make fun of people in the Middle Ages because they would build monasteries or build convents or hospitals with the money they got from ill-gotten and means. Or men who were living in adultery would go ahead and get rid of their lives and establish a convent somewhere. And they said, see, they're just trying to find their way in heaven. It's not the case. But these men knew that their adultery was wrong. They knew that their thieving was wrong. And at the end of their life, they took advantage of the time to make reparation and to establish something good, a hospital, a convent, an apostolate. In our day and age, we live through our thieving and our adultery. We say say that it's good, and we keep our money, and we make sure we have a good will and put it in a trust so that our children can get all of it. We have no sense of reparation. We call evil good. And these are the thorns that pierce the maternal heart of the Mother of God. And with that, he finishes, and she departs him into the east, as she had no one to make. So as a practical point, all I would recommend for you is that this idea of hearing the Word of God, embracing it, and observing it, the easiest way for us to do that individually is through the daily recitation of the Rosary. Because it is a contemplation of the mysteries of the Gospel, of the Messiah, the incarnate Word of God, among us, who teaches us, who shows us. So I highly encourage you, especially during this centennial year of Advent, to pick up the beads, to pick up the rosaries and to continue, and to pray faithfully each day. Take 15, 20 minutes, it's all it takes, or 24 hours, to be able to enter into this Word, so that our Lord, that as he said, my Father will love this individual, we will come to him, and we will dwell with him, and make our mansion within him. In the name of the Father, the Son, and the Holy Spirit, amen.
Make us worthy to give one another the greeting of peace with your hearts and the divine love.
each one of us give a greeting of peace to his neighbors with love and faith.
Oh, Whenever you eat this bread and drink this cup, you do so in memory of me until I come again.
We remember your death, we proclaim your resurrection. We await your glory.
We implore your mercy and compassion. We ask for the forgiveness of sins. May your mercy rest upon us. O Lord, Lord of all people, we remember your plan of salvation. And we ask you to have mercy upon your worshipers and to save your inheritance when you appear at the end of time. To reward all people justly according to their deeds. For this your church implores you and through you and with you and for your Father's sake.
Saint John the Baptist, Stephen the Archdeacon, Saint Joseph, Saint Mary, Saint Jude, and Saint And our souls purified by your forgiving blood. Thank you.
And in the end, we thank you, Lord, for his blood. Giving us your body to eat and everything else to drink for love and walk. Have mercy on us.
Have mercy on us, O Lord. O compassionate, merciful one. O Lord, of all people, have mercy on us.
Go in peace, my beloved brothers and sisters.